Hey everyone, Charting Man Dan at the Chart Guys checking in on the broader market. So when we last checked in on Thursday, a lot's happened since then, but we recognize something's going on in the financial sector. Everybody is fleeing. This is serious volume. And then on Friday, we get all the details. Everybody's talking about it. Silicon Valley Bank going under. We've got other banks going under now, total of three. We got the Fed backstop giving temporary relief, but there's a lot of money moving around. We want to know where the money is going. Where is it leaving? Money's leaving the financial sector. Today, money went to the major tech players, Apple, Microsoft, Amazon. It went to the metals, gold and silver, and it went into crypto and crypto stocks, MARA, Riot, etc. Those are the three main places money is going, and there's clearly places that money is leaving. And it's hard to imagine why you would want to put money in regional bank stocks. It's one thing to say, you know, why would you want to put money in regional banks as a depositor? And you could say, well, the Fed's backdropping you, and if they go under, you're going to be fine anyways. Okay, that's fine. But anybody that had any shares of these banks lost everything. And so why would you have any shares, want any exposure to any of these regional banks, knowing that there is this much risk in play? And so because of that, I'm keeping an eye on this ETF, KRE, which is a regional bank ETF, and just looking short. And there's great volatility. You know, there's long plays and short plays, but it's fallen apart. There's a leveraged ETF, DPST. I was shorting that today. Played it long a little bit as well, because again, there we know that there's going to be bounces. We have to protect on both sides of things, but there's your 50% bounce. There's your pullback of 15%. There's just great volatility in these names. But again, on any bounces, I'm looking short KRE. Next daily bounce, I'm going to be looking short KRE. And it's just because, again, there's no incentive to have your money in a regional bank, and there's no incentive to own shares of a regional bank right now. So just keeping that in mind on my mindset. But I did a deep dive over the weekend, spent about 6 hours on Saturday listening to Twitter Spaces and just really diving into this situation to fully understand it. And I must say, as someone who's all charts and technical analysis, that fundamental research helped me significantly knowing where to look today. I was looking long in crypto, metals, the biotech sector, and I was looking short in the regional banks, and it ended up being a good day with that just as the backdrop. So essentially the fundamentals telling me where to look and the technicals helping me with timing the entries and having the good risk reward setups. So S&P 500 got a little bit of a bounce off the low of the day. It was a notable one. This is a 30-minute time frame. So low of the day held the low of pre-market. Nice big old bounce. Higher low, lower high, and then at support, pretty much just barely broke it into the close. So we know we have to confirm hourly uptrends. We got CPI tomorrow. We got the FOMC next week. So right now, the big question is the Fed going to slow down? Are we going to do 25 basis point hike? CPI numbers are going to have an impact. If CPI is higher than expected, the Fed is going to be forced to probably have the 25 basis point raise and not pause. If CPI is lower than expected, then the Fed can have a little bit more wiggle room to potentially pause. And, you know, essentially reviewing it as, okay, the Fed raised until they broke something. And now where do we go from here? So keeping an eye on where that money is moving, because so far we've only had one business day, really two business days from when things started to become known as to what was going on. But S&P 500, no hourly uptrend at this point, has the bears still in full control. I went flat in my IRA, so I went bear lean after Thursday when we recognized that big bear volume, something's going on. A lot of unusual puts and options activity was coming in. So that was, you know, not telling in itself, but once we started to see things, okay, it makes sense. You know, people were in the know about this. So just copying something. So, CPI reaction, if it's bullish, we're going to watch for a daily lower high on the S&P 500. And if it's bearish, we're going to look to test the lows. And then we'll be looking to test the end of the year lows, which for SPY would be the mid-370s has a support zone. NASDAQ's holding on a lot better. And because of the bear break with no follow through, I try and draw a falling wedge on the NASDAQ to keep an eye on. And this is what I come up with. So if we have a bullish reaction to the CPI but reject from this resistance, then that's certainly going to be valid for me. But again, just a visual guide of something that I'm going to keep an eye on this week making note that, again, you look at, you know, where did the money go today? Well, Apple had a, we definitely saw profit taking, but Apple up 1.3%. It was up 2.5% at one point. Microsoft up over 2%. And Amazon up 1.9%. All of them were up more during the day, but again, it's clearly QQQ has the burden of responsibility. And I did a video last week and the thumbnail was QQQ bulls need help. And it's the same thing. QQQ bulls have the burden of responsibility for holding up the market right now. And they're doing their best. Healthcare was green today, but the NASDAQ bulls have a really tough task of offsetting the financial sector weakness because it's big weakness. XLF was down another 4% today. The regional bank ETF was down over 12%. So we will see big bounces in the financial sector eventually, but not yet. And I'm not trying to catch a falling knife. So we'll see what the CPI reaction gives us. NASDAQ tried to confirm the hourly trend change today, pretty much double top at the high of the day. Keep an eye on this resistance zone on the NASDAQ futures. So from Friday into today, look at these tops. This resistance zone is absolutely worth paying attention to because we have rejected from it 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 times in 2 trading days. Clearly, that's the short-term line in the sand where bears are defending a wall. If we break above it, the daily bounce is underway. And again, it's just, you know, I'm watching the broader market, and if it looks like the S&P 500 is going to bounce, I'm looking at the biotech sector, the metals, crypto, long. If it's looking like weakness, I'm looking at the financial sector weak. So depending on what I'm looking for the broader market, you know, if I'm looking for an hourly high or low, I'm looking for the bull side. If I'm looking for an hourly low or high, I'm looking on the bear side. That's dictating the names that I'm looking at, but those are pretty much the names that I'm focusing on right now. So the financial sector, big time drop over the last few days. Again, the volume standing out, still the bounce, weak. I mean, a decent little bounce there. It's a 3% bounce, but lower highs still forming, and the low of today is potentially in play tomorrow. Again, we will bounce on the daily time frame, and we will bounce over 5%, but we aren't confident that a bottom is set just yet, and we also have the fundamental aspect of things making things a little bit more tricky. So just sticking with the hourly lower highs, and we got two more on XLF today, 32.32 and 32.13. SMH is still barely clinging on to two. Actually, we broke it with no follow through. 233.09 support. Keeping an eye on NVDA divided by QQQ to see if it's going to roll over from relative strength to relative weakness. NVDA broke support today with no follow through for the bears. Pretty solid bounce from morning weakness. So again, I'm not giving up on NVDA as a bear, but the narrative certainly has bears looking elsewhere. And maybe that's going to buy some time for the NVDA bulls to keep some control here for a bit longer. Maybe this is a head and shoulders type of pattern shaping up right now, but less aggressively watching NVDA as a bear than I was last week because obviously my attention is diverted elsewhere. Tesla with a solid bounce off the lows today. Again, all bears the last few days, including this morning, big hourly bounce, no doubt about that, but we got to break the stair-step pattern, lower high every day, 6 days in a row. And then anything under 200 is just a daily lower high. And we know Tesla divided by QQQ, not today, but aside from today, has been showing us that relative weakness. Bigger picture, Tesla is looking for a weekly higher low. So we're not going to forget that. And if the bulls can put a few green days together and try and shape up a daily trend change back in their favor, then we'll be watching for that weekly higher low to be shaping up. Healthcare, big bounce today. It was a lead bull for the majority of the day, or I should say the majority of the morning, but no hourly uptrend, just a big move first thing, hourly consolidation, daily EMA 12 resistance, daily downtrend. So again, we're not seeing money fleeing the markets. We're seeing money moving around because we are not seeing all major sectors hitting the lows at the same time and, you know, the big tech names selling off with the financial sector. We're seeing money flowing into the big tech names, probably from the financial sector. So that is one note to be making here. And that if that continues, again, I'm open to the S&P 500 giving us a monthly higher low if it's this rotation kind of action. And I put out a long-term technical analysis video over the weekend. If you have not seen that yet, check out our YouTube channel. I'll link it in the comments here. But You know, I look at the metals and Bitcoin and the S&P 500 long-term timeframes, monthly, four-month, etc. IWM has a lot of exposure to the financial sector as well as, you know, startup kind of companies, low-cap companies. So big drop the last few days. We saw that weekly bear break, and the fear lows are not that far away for IWM. From the low of today, we need another 6% downside for fresh fear lows. That would be a monthly, that would be a four-month lower high and lower low if that were to break. 170.34 support is being tested. And again, another name where patient bears are saying, all right, maybe I missed this move, but you're just scouting a daily lower high. I mean, IWM can bounce 5% and you're scouting a lower high. So I will be more, you know, as I said, I've gone back to flat in my IRA. I'll be more aggressive as a bear after daily bounces and once I'm scouting those lower highs. We're keeping an eye out for volume climaxes, IWM putting up the highest daily volume in quite some time. So we'll see if that ends up being a volume climax or not. It's going to depend on the CPI reaction. Biotech sector. So I was looking bullish in the biotech sector today because, again, with some of my fundamental research, just seemed like it was overdone. The biotech sector 4-hour RSI was at historical lows. And once the depositors in these banks got the green light, you know, the biotech sector doesn't have a whole lot to worry about, certainly not as much as the financial sector. So, and we also saw the pre-market strength saying, even if we have weakness first thing this morning, we're well above the low of Friday. And so played LABU while I was live streaming this morning. And that was the first green trade of the day. It's been a really nice few days here, just getting the flow state of very actively day trading both directions and, you know, new instruments. Just having fun really is what it boils down to. KRE is now up after hours. It's not showing here. KRE is currently up over 1% after hours. And that's specific to it because the financial sector is not. Crypto names up big. Look at the volume on MARA. And Bitcoin had a mini short squeeze. I put out the crypto video earlier today. I did a live stream. So Bitcoin's testing a key resistance from a couple weeks or a couple months ago, a month ago. And if that breaks, again, the narrative is there where money is fleeing into Bitcoin without a doubt. And you can move Bitcoin around on the weekend and you're in control of it and no one, you know, can withhold that money from you. So the narrative is there for crypto and obviously bulls benefiting from that. So I'm watching backburners now. I'm watching MARA for first 5-minute oversold conditions. It's showing us more strength than Riot. I'll be looking for 5-minute oversold to play a bounce. And we'll see how long this lasts. This is one day. How long does this, the signs of where the money is going, how long does it last? Speaking of backburners, natural gas, daily higher low set. We were watching this 4-hour falling wedge pre-market. And I drew it before this bear break. So it was really nice to see a bounce right off that downtrending support line and then right back to resistance. And then we followed through nicely from there. So daily higher low is set on natural gas. We have more confidence in that falling wedge because the longer term most likely scenario is a higher low. The daily bounce was big. Tons of space for the daily higher low. You see a bullish reversal pattern forming. You trust it a lot more. If natural gas were in a daily and weekly downtrend and gave me that 4-hour falling wedge, I wouldn't care about it at all. But because the daily higher low is the most likely scenario, that 4-hour falling wedge has a higher probability. And that right there, what I just said, is a backbone for technical analysis and trading. And once that starts to click between all the time frames and how they relate, Jungle Funk Joey did that webinar that everybody had great feedback about explaining this concept. They're the pillars of technical analysis and trading. And once you understand that, everything starts to make a lot more sense and it takes a lot of time, but nothing in life that is lucrative is easy. So natural gas, daily higher low set. I wouldn't be surprised for a daily lower high to form compared to 301 because of how much we pulled back. So I'll be watching for the potential of an equilibrium, but we're trying to confirm the hourly uptrend here. And then there's a resistance zone in the 268s that we'll be watching. But shout out to Reed because back burner, 5-minute oversold conditions on natural gas, set the hourly higher low, big move up. I was talking about that trade during the crypto live stream as it was ongoing. And that's another one where, you know, I knew I was scouting crypto names for 5 minute oversold, and natural gas. Heading into midday after lunch, I said, these are the trades I'm watching for. And I took my eye off natural gas, so it was nice to have someone be like, hey, heads up, here we are. Because I probably would have missed it because I was setting up the live stream and distracted. So nice assist on that bounce. Gold, big bull move, big bull volume. Weekly bounce underway. If this is a quick little monthly high or low, I mean, we're knocking on the door of all-time highs again. And silver, monthly high or low trying to form. You bulls want to see XAU divided by XAG drop. And they want silver to be gaining on gold because in the bull markets of metals in the past, when there is confidence, silver outperforms because it's more thinly traded, it's more volatile. And so this big red day today is the first day where silver has outperformed gold meaningfully in the last month plus. So that's notable to me. And money is moving into the metals without a doubt. We're going to look for 4 hour higher lows on the metals from here. It's a runaway train. Money is, RSI goes out the window a certain bit because again, it's just everybody rushing to move this money around. And you see the same thing with Bitcoin, just rushing in. Squeezing some shorts. And again, this is money clearly moving. How long is this going to persist? The dollar, I didn't cover the dollar, did I? The dollar is weak. The big question for me over the next couple of weeks on the dollar, do we confirm a weekly uptrend for further monthly bounce? Or do we just head right back down to the lows? And the fundamental events recently are favoring dollar bears. And we're going to watch the retracement size here. But dollar weakness plus the fundamental backdrop is why the metals are performing so well the last 2 days. Oil bear break of this 2 day equilibrium we've been watching, but no follow through. We had a bull break by a few pennies with no follow through. Now we got a bear break with no follow through. Hourly is an equilibrium we're going to be watching due to the size of the bounce. We're looking for a higher low, which is likely forming. So hourly equilibrium on watch for oil. And if it breaks bull, we're going to be right back in this range, and it's going to be more like a megaphone at that point. But chopping around sideways, energy sector we've seen has been weaker than oil. It had a much more clear bear break today. But oil is just chopping around for me. I don't trade oil often anyways, but I'm just not interested in it while it's in this range. So interested in natural gas for the daily high or low. Interested in crypto names and Bitcoin itself for the relative strength. Interested in the biotech sector today. I'm not sure how long that interest is going to keep up. I was just looking for the 4 hour oversold bounce. Other than that, CPI reaction tomorrow, and we'll see how we respond to that. And I'm just taking each day with a fresh, clean slate, knowing that there's going to be opportunity in one direction or the other, not tied to a bias of direction, and taking it one day at a time. Make sure your funds are protected by FDIC insurance. Make sure you've got diversification. Make sure you've got an exit plan. If crypto, if Bitcoin narrative takes off and Bitcoin starts shooting up 30, 40,000 and the banks keep failing, you want to have a quick on-ramp to get in on that action. Lots of planning to do. I made that video a long time ago, Dan's plan when it hits the fan. It's one of the highest views videos that we have. That was pre-CVID and it ended up being really nice timing for that. But worth checking that out if you want to have some game plans established. It's always good to have game plans because otherwise you're running around with a chicken with your head cut off, reacting to your emotions. Knowledge is security. The more you know about the situation, the more you know about the markets and have confidence in your ability to move money around, the less stressful it is, the less helpless you feel. Got a lot of friends that feel real helpless right now. Doing my best, but all right, do good things. We'll see you tomorrow. Hope you had a good weekend. Another trading and nature analogy. This is a rock that I put bird seed on, and you can see there's a bunch of these little holes around the sides, and those are made by little moles or little voles who make their little tunnels, and bird seed falls into them, and they get their little meal. So the way that I view that is I'm the whale. I've got the bird seed. The mole is not trying to fight me. It's not trying to steal from me. It's just picking up the scraps. And so it's the same thing with me trading. I look to follow the whales around. I look to follow the price action and the trends. I'm not trying to beat the market. I'm trying to outperform the market,
I'm not trying to outsmart it. I'm just trying to follow the trends and get my piece of the pie, which in comparison to the whales are these tiny little crumbs, but I can do so riding their coattails and just following along. So that's one way that I'm like a vole.